Friends, colleagues and listeners, here we are again, and we're here now with the AGS, the Airline Ground Services Digital Summit. And the first guest we've got, and quite rightly so, is Fabio Gamba, who's the Managing Director, Airport Services Association. Fabio, lovely to have you on board, sir.
Thank you for having me. Thanks, Chris.
It's an absolute pleasure. So one of the things we're going to talk about, Fabio, is like the industry association. So in general, what do ground handlers require to bring ASA to a higher level? So those are the things that we'll be covering. But also, you know, you're leading up an organization that represents, you know, businesses and alliances and organizations within themselves that have had an incredibly difficult time. So from your perspective, what are the key areas that they are looking for now moving forward as to the most importance that needs to be addressed by the whole community?
Well, yeah, thank you for the question, because it's obviously a very general question. And yeah, I guess you could take probably a few hours without, you know, even starting to get to it, because I guess it all depends the perspective. But let me give it a try, right? And for a start, I would say, you mentioned about the association. How could ground handlers give it a go to try and boost the association itself? And I think it's a little bit the snake biting its own tail. The association of ASA is now, I think, getting 10 years old.
Yeah.
In 21, it got, you know, 10 years old. And it's indeed a successful association in that it boasts around 50 of amongst the major ground handlers in the world. At the same time, I do feel that when I compare the size of ASA with the size of sister associations representing other stakeholders of the air transport, you know, value chain, I realize that we know it's not comparable. Obviously, ASA is a much smaller entity. And so the question is that normal? And why is that so? And how can we make it become, you know, the same size or in a similar, say, level as the others? And by the others, I don't even mean the IATAs of this world, because obviously IATA is an animal of its own. But certainly other associations such as ACI, representing the airports, or even other perhaps more local associations representing, for instance, cargo operators, the Czechas of this world, and what have you. And I'm talking about generally in terms of influence and in terms of means. And you know, it's interesting to see that, you know, obviously ground handlers see themselves first and foremost as contractors, and amongst themselves as competitors. And rarely do they see themselves as anything else, which somehow is a shame, because they are part of the value chain. They are an essential element of the value chain. And they should understand, they do understand to a certain extent, the need for a roof association in which they can talk to each other, but also counts on such a roof association to be able to defend their interests, whether it's vis-a-vis the legislator, whether it's vis-a-vis other stakeholders. They perhaps do not have that reflex as other stakeholders do have. And this is, I would say, something that I'm getting across quite, you know, strongly from across the board. And each time I have the opportunity, I'm trying to explain that to them. Now, the question that I get back is, okay, you're asking me to become a member. What's in it for me?
Yeah. Right? Yep.
And the answer that I'm trying to give to that is, well, and I'm making it over simple here, but you know, I think probably the best answer to that question is, you know, I understand the question. Now, I think you ought to ask yourself, you know, what you can do for the association and for the segment you represent rather than what the segments can do for you.
Very Churchillian, Fabio.
Churchillian, right? or
the greater good,
or Canadian,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That said, the point is always the same. It's like, you know, you're talking to entities which by default and in their DNA see the future in the coming 6 months in terms of market share, in terms of contract. And what matters to them is signing the next contract or making sure the contract they have do not go to their competitors. That's yep. really what you're faced with. And in that, it's true that you do not tend to see the importance of an association in the same way as when you are, for instance, an airline with, you know, topics to defend, such as traffic rights, such as airport charges, this type of things, which yep. are commonly shared by the airlines. In terms of ground handling, you do have a number of, shared pain points that everyone agree with should be eliminated, but they always come as a second. And hence the reflex of belonging and going to, be a member of an association is not perceived in the same way as it is in other industries. So my task is really to try and explain to them that, hey guys, you have pain points there out there that you all share and that together we can try and tackle.
Yeah.
Individually is going to be impossible.
Yeah, but it's a shame though, isn't it? Because you know the point you were making there about the greater good and about collaboration, which is a word that's so overused at the moment, it's incredible. But there's a willingness because it's logic and it makes sense, but then there's a reluctance because of what it might or might not do to them themselves in their own positions or certain locations. Whereas now, you know, the big drivers of change, obviously, you know, you've got politics and that affect us always, politics, economy, technology, environment, and society itself. So there's so many common challenges now coming at us from all sides that I think now more than ever is the time for, you know, people to come together. And you mentioned that, you know, they all see themselves as competitors, which is good, which is great. But if you look at it, you know, the better the opposition you're playing against, it should raise your game as well. Whereas, you know, one of the most difficult things we have to contend with is this constant cost battle.
Yeah, I mean, you're absolutely right. These last 2 years have been a defining moment for the industry. At the very beginning, everyone was extremely concerned that, you know, you would see a lot of bankruptcies out there. And as a matter of fact, we've seen very few. This has shown a number of things. First of all, that the industry, and by the industry, I really mean the whole air transport value chain, but in particular, ground handling is extremely resilient. The second thing is that unfortunately, somehow, this resilience has come to a cost. And the cost of this resilience is that around 60% of our employees have been asked to go because there was not enough demand to sustain it. So that, unfortunately, that sort of resilience, or the price of that resilience, was the number of employees that we could hire. Now, a lot of people have gone, as I said, around 60% of the workforce. It's huge. It's hundreds of thousands of people who have gone. They won't come back. So we've lost, in some cases, irreplaceable expertise,
yep,
knowledge,
yep,
that we will never be able to replace. But that was the price to pay. So we can say now that with things resuming slowly, we're still talking about 23, if not 24, even in some cases 25, for a full resumption of the business as we used to know it by 2019. We will have to reinvent a little bit ourselves. We will have to see a little bit how this industry is built up, how it functions. And I think one of the first things that we can agree on is that we shouldn't go back to the pre-2019 business model, because it was a very fragile business model.
Yeah.
And this is something that you can only discuss when you are amongst yourselves, you know, picking brains, trying to think strategically for once and not only be reactive to what the market wants you to do.
Yeah.
Really, you know, sit together amongst peers and discuss, hey guys, you know, how can we make this business more, not so much resilient, because we are resilient. We've always been resilient and we will be in the future, but how can we make this business a better place to be?
Yep.
For these people and for ourselves.
Yep. Yep. 100%. 100%. Now, something that you said there about the loss of knowledge and the loss of expertise. And I mean, that's being witnessed and experienced now across the board, that, you know, certain level of feedback, complaints, frustration. And obviously now coming into the last quarter, busy quarter, especially for cargo and what should be for passenger. I mean, thank heavens, you know, the American market now is back on board. So that will shine a few lights everywhere. But when you look, I think, you know, certain lessons that have been learned, you know, one is that, you know, the load factor on the passenger flights needs to be a, you know, a more influential marker than it was ever before. But also the situation that cargo finds itself in now, whereas I think pre 2019 or early 19 or late 18, I think the price value, it was something like somewhere between 9 and 12 times more expensive for air cargo than it was sea freight, whereas now it's only 3.5 or well, it's under 4, I think, at the moment. So that's a huge, huge shift. But the bottlenecks that have caused that problem, sea freight, and the supply chain bottlenecks that are expected over the next 2 to 4, 2 to 6 months, we've got to be very careful that the services that we are providing, they need to be very transparent so the consumer can actually appreciate what they should be expecting and the reasons why perhaps it should be a little bit different to what they would have expected. And also internally and externally, what we do with people and what we do with contracts. So in the early days of the pandemic, everybody was very supportive. They were helping each other out because it was a matter of survival. And if, you know, if the water level rises, everybody's boat goes up with it. So they needed to be careful. Whereas now, I think more than ever, they need to look at what's happening and there needs to be a little bit more responsibility. I think from the very, very earliest point of the supply chain, upstream, to make sure that those capabilities and services, simplified SLAs, you know, certain basics are in place. But if they're not in place, Fabio, the companies need to be open enough and transparent enough to say that they're not.
Yeah. Well, these are excellent points, Chris. number of remarks. The first one relates to indeed what you said about, you know, number of people having lost their jobs and not returning to the industry. Obviously, this has been, you know, quite meaningful for the industry because a lot of expertise has gone for good that will not come back. And it's always complicated for an industry like ground handling, or if you will, in general, about airline contractors, to think more than X month ahead and start now trying to hire people if you feel the demand is not there. So it's always a question of supply and offer, supply and demand, sorry, and whereby you are trying to get ready for what will come next. You know, hiring people, training them, badge them, is requiring time. You don't want to do that. And of course, a lot of resources. You don't want to do that if you're not sure what tomorrow is going to be made of. And if tomorrow there's not going to be a fifth or a sixth wave of COVID-19, so you tend to be expecting things. You tend to see how things are moving. You look at the indicators, you look at your KPIs, and eventually you start making a number of, you know, decisions. And of course, the bigger you are, the more difficult these decisions are. But then obviously this creates sort of a ripple effect whereby the airlines see that, well, actually our contractors cannot follow. So we're ready to open new routes, to resume business, or actually to even go beyond what we used to have in 2019 with cargo. But unfortunately, the bottleneck comes from our contractors because they cannot follow pace because they're not enough. They don't have enough employees, and the whole thing, you know, backs for a rethinking of the whole dynamic. You know, we hear more and more that we need to digitalize this industry, because the more you are digitalized, the less you depend on human factors, at least you know, in the most obvious jobs. And that's partly true, as a matter of fact, because digitalization doesn't mean less people. It means people working differently than they used to.
Yep, but, smarter, not harder.
Yeah. But at the same time, it also means a lot of investments. Digitalization technology is a lot of, you know, requires a lot of investments. And in an industry typically that is considering the next 6 months, long-term investment, especially in these uncertain times, is extremely difficult to opt for. So that's something that I think we need to discuss. We do discuss, but perhaps at a perhaps even higher level with our friends from IATA and ACI. You know, the digitalization of the industry.
Fabio, I think. Yeah. Sorry to interrupt you there. And you just hit there on ACI again, which is just spurred. I think airports have got to take a lot more influence, accountability, responsibility, and direction strategically and tactically, because they should see themselves as being responsible for their own ecosystem. And they should lay down certain guidelines, whether it's future-proofing facilities, whether it's certain types of training, whether it's requirements, et cetera, because I've been talking to some people who've got a lot of employment agencies and they're recruiting people. Now, when there's a bit of a tsunami, you can't train the people the way they were before. So they're actually just numbers now. And, you know, with an association like yourselves, even if you had, you know, support agreements at an airport whereby you started recruiting people and training them as part of a reservoir, almost like the, you know, the draft, the US football draft, you know, where people get based on either their demand to take the draft or their rotation numbers, but at least start recruiting as a community. And then the people that need it might be at different times or whatever. So you have an equal distribution or whatever, but at least you can gauge without having all of the cost on individual companies and start sharing that platform so that there's a community support from the airport to the surrounding villages, towns, whatever it is, to say, look, you know, supply chain, fantastic career to come into. Obviously, there's been a huge blip in its history now, but looking forward, this is an incredible industry. And you, myself, you know, we've been lucky enough to live and work in different countries and experience it. And wherever an aircraft lands, you've got the same services around it, no matter what language, culture or whatever, so that those skills are transferable if you wanted to do so. So, yeah. You know, I just think now's the time to do things differently from that perspective, and also get authorities to start appreciating that. Just take where I am, you know, or anywhere, you've got different airports with different criteria, and you can't transfer staff because of security checks and them not being, you know, not being accepted in certain areas. All these things now, that I think that's got to change, and it's a great opportunity, and also changing the way people are trained, Fabio. And yeah. I keep going on about this, but the best training course I've ever been on, best ever. After 3 months, I'd forgotten over 60% of what the content was. Mm-hmm. After 6 months and realizing that I'd forgotten and reevaluating it, it was probably down to 20-25% that I thought was really useful. And after 9 months, probably maybe 5 to 12% that I would have considered critical to be used the following year. So if I'm sitting there as a head of a business unit, apart from covering, you know, regulatory criteria that has to be covered to get your certification or your acknowledgement, I'd be thinking, why am I spending so much money when it's forgotten? So instead of people talking about online, offline, face-to-face, and there's a difference now that needs to be done, because at the end of the day, it needs to be showing the impact on the business and also retention of knowledge, not a memory test after you've done 2 days in a classroom or a week, because that's all it is. It's a memory test. And it, nobody really checks what the retention of knowledge is like after a period of time. So consequently, people feel, just pay attention in the course, get your certificate, boom, whether it's linked to a grade or a position or whatever. And we're not actually doing enough with that. Does that make sense?
Well, okay, so I see three different things here in your question, and I try to address them, you know, separately, even though they're obviously intertwined. The first one is the role of apports. The second one is the attraction the industry has on the future generation, if you will, and the third one is the training aspect of it. Let me just quickly go back to the role of apports. Indeed, the apports do play a role in the whole matter, because in the end, the apport defines and gives a license to the ground handler,
yeah,
on which basis it is the sole to decide. Via the apport, the authorities express themselves. In this country, they want more or greener, if you will, operations. In that country, they don't care, and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
And obviously here, this is something that we have, you know, we have enough experience to know and to navigate through. But it's true that I think there is a point whereby we need the licenses attributed by the airports to be more in line and following a general guideline that would have been dictated either by the ICAOs of this world, or at least at the European level, by the EASA. And the good thing is this is going to happen. There are rulemaking tasks in force or being worked on at the very moment as we speak. EASA is a major stakeholder in these discussions and these reflections. And we're confident that by 2024, 2025 at the latest, there will be common regulations for airports, and hence that should reflect in not a unique set of, let's say, requirements for licenses, because obviously an airport is not like another one, but at least that the major tendencies would be reflected in these licenses. And that's a good thing. So that's positive. In terms of, you know, us attracting the new generation, that's a very difficult one, Chris, I have to say. The first comment that I want to make is we are not as attractive to the younger generation as we used to be for the previous generations. You know, air transport, aviation used to be, you know, the dream of, you know, a lot of younger kids. Certainly in my time, I used to dream about aviation. I wanted to be a pilot, just like 90% of my comrades at the time. But that's not the case anymore. That doesn't attract people anymore. And we can see in numbers that, you know, we have more and more difficulties in raising the attractiveness of the industry. And I'm not only talking about ground handling, I'm talking about the whole air transport value chain. We have more, even pilots, we have more and more difficulties in attracting them, in making them dream. And that's something that we need to together address somehow. We need to really look at how we can become more, or re-become attractive to the younger generation. And that's a difficult call that we can only win if we're sticking together and if we're selling something that makes sense to the younger generation. So we have to understand how to talk to them. And this is not a battle that so far we really have, I would say, addressed somehow.
Don't you think? Sorry, Fabio. Don't you think that as an organisation, and we're talking about collaboration and cost sharing and everything. And again, probably not the best of examples, but coming back to the US draft, you know, why couldn't 10 or 20 of your members put together like a graduate fund, so it was not huge amounts from each of them? You know, put somebody through, not just working with one company, but lots of the companies. So they took a turn in covering, whether they put them in procurement or front desk or in the, you know, baggage or in cargo warehouse. So they got a good cross section, and provided they achieved a certain level and got to a certain level, once that milestone was passed, any of those companies could bid for that person to recruit them and offer them employment. And once that would get off the ground, I mean, that would be quite a unique sort of opportunity for certain individuals who are already thinking that aviation would be for them, but also to map out a sort of a career path that if you went through those basic criteria, where you could actually be and not feel aggrieved if that person then moved on to another company within that sector, because it's all about promoting that career concept rather than, you know, I've heard so many people say, no, we train them too much, it costs too much, and then they leave us. Well, the worst point is if you don't train your people, they'll stay with you. And, you know, I just think a different mindset now, and yeah, a different opportunity, you know, you could start really pulling some people in.
No, you're absolutely right. And this is something that we are taking extremely seriously, as you may think. We have put in place a number of, programs. And by we, I mostly mean ASA members. But ASA itself is looking at proposing all round internships as a way to boost not only the interest, but also then the expertise of these people and make the job more attractive and sell it as a potential for a career. And so this is something that we are not only thinking of and already starting working on, but we're already trying to offer a number of actions, concrete actions there, but it's taking time. And again, we are really faced with this lack of interest from people who see aviation, air transport, as an industry that's is an industry of the past. They're looking now at virtual aspects, everything related to IT and everything. And I think it would be a major challenge for this industry to try and sell itself still as an industry of today that is irreplaceable. It's interesting because at the same time, the digitalization of the industry is somehow working against us. And at the same time, it is supposed to help us because, as we said, it's not changing the number of people that we need to work with. It's changing the nature of the job and making it more interesting. So we are in the midst of this reflection somehow to try and redress a little bit the image of the sector and rebuild the ties that we have lost with the new generation to try and explain, well, look, guys, this job is not only about pushing back an aircraft. It's not only about taking the luggage out of this aircraft. It's so much more than this. And a career here would allow you to do so many more things. This is something that we will have to address, that we are trying to address, but it's taking a lot of time and resources. And we haven't yet found the philosopher's stone, if I may say.
Yeah, we don't have people who can sell it well. And the other issue is they're not allowed to sell it the way they would like to sell it because of the rigidity of what you just said there about understanding the whole process. And one of those areas comes from the fact that whether it's unionized or in some cases it's ego, it's silo mentalities within the industry, they don't allow people to multi-skill, cross-skill, upskill so that they as an individual become more of a value and more flexible. And like I've worked and I've been responsible for people, spending, 12 hours in a warehouse or on a ramp and stuff, and it's killing. But why not have a different approach whereby you give them 7 hours and then the rest of the time, either at the front end or the back end, they're actually doing more administrative work or white collar work, whereby they're understanding the importance of accuracy coming to them and what they do with what they get, and then how it feeds down the rest of the area. And also, being able to do 3 shifts on the ramp, 2 in warehouse, on cargo, whatever it is. And the more flexible and the more competence that you can prove or is verified as retention of knowledge, that is what should differentiate your salary at the end of the month.
Yeah.
And things like that, whereby people and then You mentioned there about, the youth. Yeah, of course. And everybody's talking about the youth. And it's lovely to see the next generation taking so much interest in the environment. But they also have to understand the realities of life, which is, you know, people, profit, planet. If you've got people who think they can fix the planet without organizations making profit, well, they're going to keep marching and protesting, and things aren't going to get done just because of marching and protesting. So there's a balance. And, you know, everybody like my generation now, and I'm hearing lots of them saying, oh, we've got to change and we've got to be TikTok focused. That's not going to solve the issue. The issue is a holistic one, and it's about regenerating interest and enthusiasm and engagement and disciplines, Fabio. And if we started to do that a little bit more now, and especially break, this is an opportunity to break down all those restrictions that allow other disruptors to come into our industry and take advantage of the handicaps that we don't want to cure.
You're absolutely right. I mean, you're preaching to the choir, obviously. I'm absolutely with you. Indeed, I think we have encountered a number of difficulties in understanding the new generation and understanding what they want to hear. This is something that we realize we absolutely and urgently need to do. That digitalization is not going to happen overnight, and we will need skills still. So I think this is something that we've put in place together with our sister associations, ACI and IATA and a few others as well. And we really want to address this in the most important way. Perhaps we were not conscious of that much in the past. I think with the crisis, with the COVID-19 epidemic, we've realized that this was actually an urgent thing. So at least it has shed light on that need and on the fact that we definitely need to do this, and we are working on that. With respect to training, the what you mentioned, Chris, obviously there's so much that an association can do. I will leave it to the members to define how best they can train their people and how best they can keep them and use their skills and expertise in the best possible way. What we can do, though, is to do something that you alluded to previously, Chris, which is to try and make sure that people see their job and their skills as being recognized.
Yes,
it was not in the past. So it means that if you have worked for this company at that airport, and let's be honest amongst ourselves, blue collars won't move from one country to another simply because they've been offered a job at another station in another country. That won't happen. But what could happen is that if you have been X years in a company at that station, and then you may use your skills that you have accumulated for company X at that station in company Y at that station, because that changes all the time.
Or Fabio, recognizing somebody as being a peer advocate of excellence, and because they've been so good, then relocate them to one of the other locations so that they can impart their best practice and their examples, and also for them to see what goes on in other areas, which could be either a motivation to then come back and change as well. So there's lots of ways of recognizing people and letting people feel, as special as they should do. And, you can have dashboards and stats and on-time performance, and people overemphasize certain elements of the business, but it's the score on the floor and the feet on the ground that still are making that difference. And sometimes they're forgotten. And I think that's such a shame when you meet them and you listen to people who've done X amount of years, and they actually feel as if they're leaving with a suitcase that was emptier than when they came in. Mm-hmm. And that's a sad thing. And I think, that's something that we have to try and see how you spice it up a little bit, which I think, upskilling, new skilling, letting people know that they can enhance their own personal asset value. And you mentioned there about airports again. Airports could put certain competencies into those license criteria. so they could actually start to steer something. And like I said, again, if, you know, if I had the opportunity and I was at an airport, you know, I'd create my own Academy of Excellence at an airport that would feed into the rest of the organizations, even if they ended up getting a recruitment fee at the end of it to go towards it, or everybody at the airport contributed or whatever. But we've got to start doing something very, very different now, you know, to get people in. And the other thing is we should be focusing as well on getting experts from other industries into our industry, because they want to, and because they want to bring some of those specializations in. And that I don't think we do as well, you know. So I think there's fantastic opportunities, Fabio, as you do.
always. And the pandemic has shown us that, again, we need to think the issue from, you know, different angles that we hadn't thought of before. But definitely training and the, you know, people. Although we hadn't perhaps realized that to that extent, at least, are the very center of our future. And we need to not only realize this, I think we've long realized that, but we need to do something that, you know, boosts this element of having the feeling that people can do a career out of this. And
yeah.
And that's what the association as a roof trade body can do, and that's what we're trying to do. Now, to be concrete, what we're trying to offer is to come up with the recognition of skills that could, you know, yeah, allow people to move from company A to company B, whether at the same station, whether at the same let's say country, or whether in different countries, doesn't matter. That's what we can offer, and that's what we're trying to work on together with our sister associations. It's really, in my opinion, one of the most pressing challenges that this industry is faced with, to try and continue to keep people's interest and attention, and to try and make sure that people will want to improve themselves and believe in this job, as you know, for their future career. That's crucially important.
100%. And the more they do, and the more they understand the impact of it, because again, now, and like we both skirted on certain areas for the subject of this particular discussion, but also, you know, the two most important pillars, safety and security. As you lose so much experience and you have to bring lots more people in, and they come in under a very pressurized environment, and you know, it's really going to be tough. The chances of incidents increasing or certain things going wrong, you know, that's something that everybody has got to focus on, but not just fear. And at the moment, it's a fear, because those levels of incidents are creeping up. And, you know, we've got to be very, very careful.
Yeah, no, I mean, you certainly have a point. At the same time, I cannot believe that such an, you know, adults and mature industry will let corners being cut that much. We just like the airlines, are under so much scrutiny that I don't believe, even though we have lost many skills and expertise, as we've said before, that would be allowed to happen. Now, it might be that there might be some accidents or incidents, cropping up here and there. In general, though, I do believe that this industry is extremely safe, because safety is the cornerstone of our being there, right? So I'm not too worried about that. I'm more worried about, let's say, the short-term indeed incidents, that the fact that we have lost so many people may have in the coming weeks and months, now that things are resuming, and how we can responds to a growing demands without you know, having to cut corners. So that's more a short-term thing. I would say that in the longer term, I'm absolutely confident this industry has all it requires in order to be and remain super, super safe, because it's at the very core of whatever we do. Right? This is the very reason of our job. And by the way, I would add to this, if I may, Chris.
Yep.
And we, as an association, welcome a number of initiatives from the regulators around the world. There has been first and foremost a recognition by the European Union of the importance, the essential importance of a safe ground handling for the safety of transport. It might seem absolutely obvious, but when you think about this, it's only recently that this has been formally recognized.
Yep.
The basic
yep.
regulation of EASA dates back 2018,
yep.
3 years. And it's yep. only for the last 3 years that EASA said, okay, we need to integrate ground handling within the safe operations and force eventually ground handlers to follow an SMS. The same applies to ICAO, which has come up with a very very useful documents on ground handling, SMS by the ground handling task force, and this is the prelude to more to come. So this is great because it will only help ground handlers improve the safety operations via the SMS, for instance.
Yeah.
But it also shows that there is a wider conscience that, as a matter of fact, air transport is a whole ecosystem, and that you can not only address a safe operations of an aircraft without impacting or without touching on the rest, and so it's very positive, and we are true. We're following that with a lot of interest, and actually with our input as well.
Yeah, no, I 100% endorse what you're saying. I think what EASA, ICAO, and especially the SMS programs and understanding, it's incredible, and it's so important. And also what you said about the industry being so safe, amazing, amazing. You look at it over the last 30, 40, 50 years, I mean, it's phenomenal how well it's done. And I just want to make something clear. I wasn't talking about corners being cut. I'm talking about the next 3 to 6 to 9 months for this particular reason, which is unique. Yeah. And in my opinion now, it's as much about attitude, aptitude, and care, and how it's being shown to employees who come into the industry by the way their leaders lead, okay? Because they see that. And what I would have to say, even with IOSA audits, there are so many people who say, oh, we got zero findings. I'm sure the same as you, Fabio. If you go to any organization, any airport, and you walked out of there and said you found zero findings, you'd want to kick yourself in your own backside with both legs, because it doesn't make sense. So that understanding and culture, that the more you find out about your organization, the fitter and the better you will be if you have the right culture, one of care, one of the correct attitude, and that the leaders lead by example. Because even with SMS, people are putting policies up. They've got their manual. They've got all of their issues, and they do not follow it. It's an administrative guideline through a murky situation where they're being dictated that they have to do it. And unfortunately, whether it's to do with resource or commitment, the authorities then don't, they bark, but they don't bite. That's why, please God, nothing will happen, because as you know as well, the trivial many, if not addressed, will become the critical few. And reputation and incident is one of the biggest drivers of our industry, which is the forced way of learning, which, hopefully, touch wood, there's a lot of it up here, those sort of things will be taken very, very seriously now.
Well, yeah, if I can just rebound to or react to what you just said, Chris, I think one of the major elements for ground handling, it might sound very, very obvious, but it is not so obvious, is the introduction of just culture.
Yep.
Into ground handling. I mean, just culture has been a cornerstone of transport for the last 30 years or whatever,
yep.
Even though not all take it implemented in the same way, obviously. There are different mentalities, there are different traditions and what have you. And so it has to go through all these the difficulties and through all these filters. For ground handling, it's something that is more novel, if you will, and not all of the organizations doing ground handling have yet understood the importance of the cornerstone, if you will, of you know, introducing just culture in their operations. And this is something that we're trying to distillate little by little to our members and beyond, with the help of the legislator and what have you. And for instance, we've come up with a program that allows now our members to, you know, benchmark themselves in terms in terms of you know, grounds damages or ground occurrences, and doing so in a way that obviously there are no responsibility in particular. We're not interested in, you know, into identifying those who have or the source of the occurrence. We're more interested to understand why it has happened and what it has caused. And then as a second step, to try and have an understanding of in which conditions these occurrences happen, so as for our members and for everyone who partake in this exercise to anticipate things and then to make the improvements where they are necessary. But all this is predicated on the diffusion of just culture, and just culture is at the root of this being possible. Otherwise, people will always try to hide, not report, and then you're not making any you know, improvements. You're just trying to hide what you can hide, and that's not a way to work. So, just culture, as obvious as it may sound, is still needs to be better implemented, understood. And then we'll be at the root of this successful benchmarking ASA that we're trying to promote.
Yeah, no, 100%, Fabio. And you know, with so many different cultures and egos and ways systems are made up and people interact with each other, it's almost a paradox where you're telling people you should report when you've made a mistake, because you know, some areas can't deal with that, but that's where the education and the enforcement needs to go. So listen, Fabio, we're at the end of the period. I know how much you care, and you know, we all wish you great success with ASA and also the members, and look forward to talking to you again in the future. And you know, please God, this next 3 to 9 months will go well for the entire industry, across the industry, and we'll start getting more recognition globally to, you know, attract people to come into the industry, whether it's as a new opportunity, new career, or coming across from other industries where they can bring specialization and help us.
Well, thanks, Chris, for having me. I'm pretty sure that things will be positive in the coming weeks and months. I think that the trend is positive. And I'm quite optimistic with respect to the future of this industry, but that will certainly not go without any fundamental transformation. That's what makes it so interesting. So thanks for having ASA and me to this webinar, and look forward to the next time.
Indeed, sir. All right. Thank you so much, Fabio. Good luck.
Cheers. Thank you.
Cheers.